pensando nas nossas relações, no trabalho, no amor, na família? Estamos cuidando dos nossos vínculos afetivos? Que referências e valores têm norteado nossas ações? Por que a compreensão de uma mudança de era pode nos ajudar a viver melhor o nosso dia a dia? Na última década, o Café Filosófico trouxe pensadores que nos ajudaram a ampliar as possibilidades de compreensão do mundo em que vivemos.
É importante de desenvolver a educação temas fundamentais que não se encontram no sistema educativo. Por quê? Porque são temas que necessitam de religar muitas disciplinas separadas. Por que não se ensina o que significa ser humano?
O seul moyen que je connaisse de lutter contre la consommation addictive, c'est de donner à nos enfants le sentiment qu'il y a des choses plus belles et plus importantes. C'est vital de raconter à nos petits, quand ils ont 4 ans, 5 ans, 6 ans, des contes de fées, la mythologie grecque, pour leur donner le sentiment qu'il y a des choses qui sont supérieures au seul registre de la consommation. L'éducation, c'est l'amour, la loi, les œuvres. Et il faut les trois.
And I came to the conclusion that there are two essential values which are absolutely indispensable for satisfying, rewarding, relatively happy life. One is security, the other is freedom. We will never find the perfect solution of the dilemma between security and freedom. There always will be too much of one and too little of the other, right?
La beauté sauvera le monde. La beauté, c'est celle du geste humain. C'est la possibilité d'aimer les personnes autour de soi. C'est parvenir à charger de sens, de vérité, les gestes les plus quotidiens, nos rapports avec les personnes que nous côtoyons, avec notre métier, avec nos enfants et donc aussi avec notre travail.
Neste programa, vamos ver alguns temas que estão na pauta de três importantes pensadores internacionais da atualidade. O sentido da justiça e bem-estar social, pelo economista indiano Amartya Sen.
Well, I hope so. I don't know. It depends on...
O que está por trás do conceito de pós-modernismo e como ele alterou nossa consciência espacial, pelo crítico literário norte-americano Frederick Jameson.
Of time by space.
O desafio de aproximar a filosofia ao nosso cotidiano, com o filósofo britânico Simon Blackburn. O que define uma época? Que mudanças evidenciam a passagem para um novo momento histórico? Qual é a nossa condição contemporânea? Muitos autores nomeiam o nosso tempo como pós-modernismo, em oposição à modernidade, que era marcada pela excessiva confiança na razão e na visão mecanicista do mundo. Um destes autores é o crítico literário norte-americano Frederick Jameson, que neste programa fala sobre algumas dessas mudanças na economia e no campo estético.
I began to be interested in the idea of postmodernism, I suppose in the late 70s and early 80s. But I came to it really through architecture. And through the sense I had begun to work with some architects in the early 80s. And I had the sense, first of all, that architecture itself was undergoing a profound transformation and that all the interesting architects were talking about the end of modern architecture, that is to say, Le Corbusier, Mies, and so on and so forth. The iconic picture of the end of modernism was an enormous housing complex in the sort of standard modern style, I think in St. Louis, I think it's called Pruitt-Igoe, And this housing complex was blown up, was destroyed. So the image of the destruction of this building was for the architects a kind of emblem of the end of modernity. And what replaced that was a very different kind of architecture, one that was much less severe, that made less absolute demands, that was friendlier, that was more decorative. And it was clear that this was something of a new style. And postmodernism then became the appropriate word for this new kind of architecture. I then began to ask people, the architects, for example, when they thought this change began. What I began to feel was that this was not just a change in architecture, but it was a change on many different levels of social life. And perhaps it was a change that was more significant. Well, I won't say it was more significant than the 60s, which of course were a fundamental moment of change for many of our societies, but it was the consequence of the 60s. It was what, for us in America, what came out of the end of the Vietnam War, the defeat in Vietnam, this new era that we began to enter at that point. And in my investigations of postmodernism, it was important to me not just to describe this in architecture or in literature, but to make connections with what one might call other levels of social life. That could be daily life itself, but it would certainly have to include politics, economics, and so on and so forth. And I think that after a while one realizes, and I think today everyone realizes, that around this period, maybe 1980 or so, fundamental changes were taking place in society, which left us in a very different place from the older period. The most obvious change, of course, was the introduction of the personal computer. It seems to me that that's a fundamental transformation. That marked a fundamental transformation in people's lives and gradually in the whole object world around us. And we forget that. I mean, even the VCR itself came into being in the early 80s, and so on and so forth. One can begin to collect these signs of change. Now, I don't think one has to think in terms of causality. Society is a, I don't want to say a seamless web, but nonetheless, all of these various phenomena are interrelated. They echo each other. They are maybe symptoms of some fundamental central reality. And therefore, the more one observes of them, the more complete a sense one has of the nature of this change.
No próximo bloco, com Frederick Jameson, Tempo e Espaço Pós-Modernos. A partir da segunda metade do século XX, as mudanças ocorridas na arquitetura evidenciavam o início de uma nova época, batizada por diversos autores de pós-modernismo, que logo foi identificado não como um movimento isolado, mas sim como uma nova estrutura social, efeito da globalização, onde as diversas áreas da sociedade passaram a estabelecer inter-relações.
One can see this as a transformation of our economic system. Now, I never wanted to say that we were in a different economic system. It seems to me we're still very much in capitalism, but we're in a different moment of capitalism. So I posit three moments of capitalism. A national moment, that was what Marx was writing about in the 19th century. Then a new moment of expansion, which is what Lenin writes about in imperialism, and which is indeed the beginning of an imperial capitalism, the conquest of colonies. So what's being suggested here by this idea of postmodernism is that now we've reached a third stage of capitalism, which I would call postmodern capitalism, which is marked by information technology, which is marked also by decolonization. There are still relations of domination all over the world, obviously, economic domination, but of a very different type than the older colonial type. This is a period dominated by finance capital, and that's a very special thing. And it is indeed, I think, very closely related to the postmodern phenomena. I was first writing on this subject, I made a mistake, which I think was quite comprehensible at the time, and it was to call this postmodernism, because there was a postmodern style in these things. And then people came along and they said, well, you know, postmodernism is over, nobody builds buildings that way anymore, we're in a new period, and so on and so forth. And at that point I realized that I was not talking about a style, postmodernism, I was talking about a social structure, a system, and therefore now I would prefer to speak of post-modernity in general, as opposed to the older modernity, and as opposed to what came before that. The reason I think I wasn't aware of that, and the other omission in the first things I wrote, was that a word began to be used, I would say in the mid-1980s, which suddenly cast a whole new light on all of this. And this word was globalization. Hard for us to remember there was a time when nobody used a word like that, but globalization did emerge at that point, and that's at that point also that I understood that that was what was lacking in my description of postmodernity, that globalization was the let's say, the infrastructure of which postmodernity was the superstructure, if you like, that these were two faces of the same reality.
Há tempo de nascer e tempo de morrer. Tempo de plantar e tempo de arrancar o que se plantou. Tempo de matar e tempo de curar. Tempo de derrubar e tempo de edificar. Tempo de chorar e tempo de rir. Tempo de prantear e tempo de dançar. Que proveito tem um trabalhador naquilo que trabalha? De que forma o pós-modernismo alterou a nossa maneira de nos relacionar com o tempo e com o espaço?
Precisely one of the great shifts from the modern to the postmodern is the shift from the dominance, let's think in structural terms, you have a dominant, subordinates and so forth. The dominant of time in the modern to the dominant of space in the postmodern. If you think of modern literature, it's obvious that the great modern novels, I mean, it's a cliche to say that Thomas Mann, Proust, and so on and so forth, all of these novels are saturated with time, with the sense of time, the obsession with time, and so on and so forth. It is the period of great experiments in music, which are above all constructions of new temporalities, experiments in temporality. I think that today space has taken the come to the fore over temporality, and this has several consequences. Why should this be so? Well, how does one explain the modern obsession with time? I just throw this out as a possibility. It seems to me that The modern modernism was the period of modernism was characterized by an uneven development, which we might describe as an incomplete modernization. There were still older, there was still an older agriculture. There were still peasants. There were still older parts of the city, older professions, professions that had not been swept up into the bureaucratic organization of modernity, and so on and so forth. I think that in that period, people moved from one temporality to another. People grew up in their village, they came to the big city, a city dominated by speed and of almost inhuman kind. And therefore, they were somehow sensitized to temporality such, to variations in temporality. I think that with postmodernity, we arrive at a much more complete modernization. I always take agriculture as an example because I think that there is a relationship between a national culture and agriculture and peasant life. And I think that to the degree that the Green Revolution destroys the older agriculture, to the degree that the great agribusinesses transform peasants into farm workers, to the degree that these genetic crops replace, let's call them natural crops, I think much is transformed. And one must say that nature in that sense, in nature in the older sense, ceases to exist and is replaced by the artificial in the sense of the man-made, let's say. I think that therefore existentially, there is not the same kind of there's not the same kind of sensitization to these variations in time. Instead, what we have around us is a world of built space, as far as the eye can see. It is a new spatial politics of land grabs, struggles over regions, and so on and so forth. If one's talking about existential experience, I think it may go something like this. That is to say, what is the status of time under a regime of space? Since I'm affirming this priority of space, what happens to time in that? I think that time becomes reduced to the present. And the present for each of us is the body, and therefore, which is spatial. And therefore, there's a reduction, there's a gradual waning of our sense of past and future. Does it impinge on personal identity? I think to a certain degree. That is to say, I think that the 19th century novels show that people had a sense of their biographical destiny and its duration in time that maybe we don't have anymore. At any rate, I think that in the arts, everywhere one can see this reduction to the present and to the body, which is another sign of the supersession of time by space in the postmodern, and there would be, of course, more to say about that.
No próximo bloco, com Amartya Sen.
The really interesting question is not what is happiness, but how important is it in our evaluation?
Justiça, injustiça e a busca pela felicidade. Construir uma sociedade mais justa. Esse é o objetivo de incontáveis discussões, políticas públicas e atuações sociais no mundo todo. Mas para alcançar esse objetivo, é necessário primeiro responder uma pergunta aparentemente simples. Afinal, o que é a justiça?
The answer to the question, what is justice, is to understand the question to be one about increasing justice or reducing justice. I argue in my book, The Idea of Justice, that to think of the theory of justice in terms of identifying an ideally just set of arrangements is always a mistake. We have disagreements among them, which do not arise only from vested interests or personal concerns. It also arises from the fact that we have different approaches to justice. But we can still agree on many things about how to remove what appears to us to be manifest injustice and thereby enhance the pursuit of justice. So the whole issue of what is justice is not answerable in that form, but it is about how to increase justice, reduce injustice. That's what the debate has always been about. I think what the society has to do is to make sure that the lines on which we agree that justice could be enhanced are pursued, and that requires paying attention to development as well, which is particularly important, as I try to say in my earlier book, Development and Freedom, that development, it's about more education, more secure health care, and better health care, and also social security and human security in general. So I think we have to view all these other issues like growth and so on in derivative terms. Economic growth can be very important, indeed it is very important, but not for its own sake, but for what it does to enhance people's lives and their freedoms. I begin my book with a quotation from Charles Dickens. Someone is discussing his childhood and how he was unjustly treated. We are all the time thinking about that.
No pequeno mundo em que as crianças vivem a sua existência, nada há que seja mais finamente percebido e sentido do que a injustiça.
The question is that quite often our views are very different about how justice should be pursued. Some people would give much greater importance to liberty, some people even to concern with one's possessions and property. Others would give much more importance to people's basic living and the freedoms that they enjoy, the well-being they have, the medical care they receive, the education they have the opportunity to have. And so all these concerns come in, and I have a position on that, but there are two really different things here. One is, what is my position on this question? And the other is, how do you think, when we disagree, these differences could be resolved? And the resolution has to be in terms of public discussion, exchange of views, interactive scrutiny. Now, that doesn't mean every difference would be resolved, but many would be. And those which are then become the ripe candidates to be pursued by the society. But these things, these agreements won't emerge without the reasoning. These are not antecedent gut agreement. Mm-hmm. It doesn't operate in the guts, it works on the brain. So you have to look at, after reasoning, what we find, okay, this is reasonable, I'm ready to accept it. Co-responsibility is always very important when some people are trying to act together to achieve some result. I think the real trouble with the Copenhagen summit is because they didn't have any discussion about anything else other than some fixing of co-responsibility mm-hmm. by Europeans who wanted to fix a certain limit and ask the Chinese, the Brazilians, South Africans and Indians to fall in line. That was never going to happen. And there were also small islands here and there, all kinds of things.
O encontro de Copenhague foi uma conferência das Nações Unidas sobre as mudanças climáticas e aconteceu em 2009. Apesar da presença de diversos líderes mundiais e da ampla divulgação pela mídia, o encontro foi encerrado sem que grandes consensos tenham sido alcançados e sem que acordos legais tenham sido assinados.
I think what you need is to see what there are different types of co-responsibility. Co-responsible for what? You know, Europeans, the Chinese point out that Europeans and North Americans have polluted the world for 102 years. And suddenly when the Chinese start polluting, they tell the Chinese, stop it, the games are all changed now. Well, I mean, the Chinese think this is very unfair. On the other hand, the idea the Chinese can't get away with the idea that they can pollute as they like. So we have to arrive at some kind of a fair settlement. But the fair settlement can happen only on the basis of public discussion as to, yes, we take into account the European and American as having already filled up the biosphere with their debris, and what room is there for Brazil, South Africa, China, or India, and so on. And then, given what China, India, Brazil, and South Africa do, what room is left for the countries which are still not going at all, and not started industrializing? What happens to Sudan, Ethiopia, Somalia, the Sahel countries? What happens to some extent in Ghana and so on? Only Nigeria had some of these industrial development, and so one has to see. We have to live together in a universe, and particularly this globe, and we have to find fair settlement, taking into account history as well as the possibilities today. And then, on the basis of a fairly arrived contract, there could be co-responsibility. Where Copenhagen failed is that they wanted to get a contract with no discussion. Europeans having arrived at in the European soil and said, here it is, it's a fair agreement. Well, that's not the way to do it. The way to do it is to have much more extensive public discussion. And then to portray that anyone who didn't agree with the Europeans must be irresponsible is a very silly way of understanding what went wrong in Copenhagen. It is that agreement without precedent discussion is never going to come to pass. So I think the leadership has a problem. The Europeans would probably like to take the leadership, and they have a right to do so. But on the other hand, they have to also listen to the different concerns that come from already developing countries that are already developing fast, like Brazil or China or India, and developing countries that are not yet developing fast. And so all these are different parties, and they have to air their view. On top of that, there are some new issues. You can save the global warming problem with using nuclear fuel, which is still quite expensive compared with coal and oil, but the hope was that it will become cheaper. But then Fukushima disaster brings out, in a country of great scientific achievement and tremendous discipline, that it can still cause absolute havoc. And had it happened in countries which are not as disciplined, the result could have been disaster.
O desastre da usina nuclear de Fukushima, no Japão, em março de 2011, foi um dos maiores acidentes nucleares da história. Um terremoto seguido por um tsunami causaram explosões e a fusão de 3 reatores da usina. O acidente causou a liberação de material radioativo no oceano e na atmosfera. Estima-se que o processo de limpeza e descontaminação da área em volta da usina irá demorar ao menos 40 anos. Após o desastre, o Japão entrou num processo de erradicação da energia nuclear, movimento que está sendo seguido por diversos outros países.
So when that, is it all right to fill the world with hundreds of thousands of these nuclear reactors? I think that would be that could be very serious indeed. So one has to think about to what extent, through proper subsidy, solar, wind power, and other things can be pursued. And if it can be pursued, how economic can you make it? Does it become economic after taking into account the externalities of coal, for example, for the global warming, and the externalities of nuclear power for the danger of sabotage, accident, or stealing of nuclear material, which is quite a serious issue when you have it everywhere. It's not so hard to get it think stealing takes place in the world all the time.
Um mundo mais justo é um mundo mais feliz. E se é difícil até mesmo definir o que é justiça, então também temos que perguntar: o que é a felicidade?
Well, my concept of happiness isn't any different, I hope, from yours. I think happiness is a word, and if you follow the lines of analysis presented by Wittgenstein, we follow certain rules in describing understanding what. If you see a person crying in the street, you just say, gosh, this person must be very happy, because that's not the rule we follow. So we tend to follow that. The really interesting question is not what is happiness, but how important is it in our evaluation? Because, you know, some people regard, and utilitarians do, that that's the only thing that ultimately matters. Anything that makes you happy would be fine. So that if you're put in a pleasure machine, as Robert Nozick discussed, and strapped to it, but there's some kind of drug given to you, or some kind of sensational creating movement made, so you feel very happy, then you are leading a very good life. Now, on the other hand, I would say that you're trapped in a chair and you can't get up, and you are being, a lot of things are being done to you, which is not something you choose. So I would regard to be a pretty bad life. So I think one has to think about the importance of happiness. I certainly don't take the view that happiness is the only thing that matters. But given other things, is happiness important? Yeah. It's not a measure of everything, but in itself, yes, indeed. And happiness of a different kind. There is comfort, there is stimulation. You could be very comfortable and no stimulation at all. Or you could have huge stimulation and thoroughly uncomfortable, like Mozart might have been. And so in all kinds of ways, you have different elements in happiness. I once wrote a paper called Plural Utility, which I'm not asking you to read. Came out with a classical journal called Proceedings of the Aristotelian Society. But my question, my concern here is how to assess happiness, how do we understand the different elements in it, rather than what is happiness. There we're trying to follow the rules that the language has given us.
No próximo bloco, com Simon Blackburn.
Think of myself as somebody who brings people to philosophy. I don't bring philosophy to people. It's the power of ideas, the difficulty of ideas, the reason why taking command of ideas is so important. And
o prazer da filosofia. Conhecer-se a si mesmo, aprender a pensar, fazer como se nada fosse evidente, espantar-se. Estas determinações da filosofia, entre tantas outras, fazem do filosofar uma atividade que parece muito longe do nosso dia a dia. Mas filosofia é mesmo tão distante das nossas vidas e reservada aos intelectuais do mundo acadêmico? Não. O filósofo britânico Simon Blackburn demonstra como o nosso modo de ver o mundo pode se tornar um prazeroso exercício filosófico.
One advantage of philosophy and of the history of ideas, the philosophy of ideas and the history of ideas, is that it opens the student's mind to the difficulties involved in even the most elementary sounding concept, a concept that you might think is the property of the whole world, that has no history, it's always been part of the thought processes of mankind. And if you learn that concepts are not, they have a life, they have a history, they have a pattern of discovery, a pattern of refinement, a pattern of change, then you learn something very important about our minds and eventually about our lives and our politics. Because I think one of the most dangerous political ideas is the idea that our way is the only way. We are the only people of reason, or we are the only people to have got something right. Our way is the best way. I think opening your mind to other ways of thought, which is one of the things that philosophy and history most certainly do for you, is a very important educational device. And without it, think of what we risk. Socrates is supposed to have said that the unexamined life is not worth living. Hegel said that philosophy is the queen of the sciences. Nowadays, I think if you took a snap poll on the internet, what's the queen of the sciences? People would say physics. Physics, perhaps mathematics, mathematical physics. Why did Hegel think that philosophy was? Well, he may have had bad reasons, but I think he had good reasons. And the good reason was that all paths lead to reflection. A physicist may do wonderful work based on a particular set of concepts with a particular set of problems. But eventually, he's going to use terms like energy, time, entropy in his thoughts about physical systems. And if he starts to reflect, he's going to ask of the nature of those concepts, what's their identity, what do they really mean, how do we measure them, is their meaning just given by the way that we measure them, or is something else involved? And those are philosophical questions. They're questions in which the concepts which he normally uses themselves become the topic of interest. And I think that's characteristic of philosophy. One metaphor to explain that might be this, that when you look at the world, you look at the world deploying a set of categories, using a set of thoughts. One of the few things that all psychologists and philosophers agree about now is that there is no such thing as the innocent eye. Your eye is trained. Your eye is the eye of somebody who has your human experience, has learnt to detect various saliences in the scene around you, to notice some things, to fail to notice other things, to categorize the world in a certain way. Philosophy arises when those categories are themselves the subject of your vision. You turn your attention onto the lens through which you normally see the world. The lens formed by your preconceived ideas, your culturally embedded traditions and habits, the things that you naturally interpret the world in terms of, then become the topics of thought. But I think nobody is so innocent as to think that their way of perceiving the world is the only possible way of perceiving the world. And then you have to ask yourself, what is the justification of the categories you bring to the world? Are there alternatives? Could they do better? Could they be refined? Could they be more clear? Could you be helped to understand them better, to understand the roots of inference, the practices in which they become embedded and to which they give rise? So ideas are the most important determinants of our lives in many ways. Of course, other things are too. Energy is very important. I have to say this in this building. Energy is very important. But ideas will determine who can pay for the energy, who can deploy the world's resources, how they are to be allocated. Those will be ideas to do with the, for example, the different roles of the market and the different roles of the body politic, of the social and political structures that we live in. We saw a very strange sea change in the climate of ideas. It was the view that created in Europe the welfare state, the idea that the collective, the body politic, the nation or the group, we all hung together. People deserved, therefore, if they couldn't afford it, they deserved free education. If they couldn't afford it, they deserved free medicine. They deserved that the state look after us, take care of our vulnerable side, our dependencies, basically from birth to death. And that was a consensus in Europe, certainly, before the Second World War, but it gained in speed after the Second World War. Suddenly people started saying things like greed is good. Private contract became sacrosanct. The wisdom of the market, the idea that you could have simply individual atoms, selfish atoms, self-interested, atomistic, individual people, owing no identity to society, no identity to their culture, their surrounding, their politics, free individual agents. And the ideal political and social arrangement was one in which these free agents simply tried to maximize their own profits or their own pleasure or their own economic well-being by means of interchange, free market interchange with each other. This became the ideology of the market, the ideology of the free market. Why did this happen in 1979? I don't know the answer. I guess the terms of cooperation which make up a society or a collective had begun to seem wrong to the people who felt that the amount they were contributing to the social good was more than the amount they were getting out of it. So they naturally felt they could form a breakaway. We, the rich, can, as it were, afford to ignore the poor. The poor are being parasitic upon the rich. And that became the set of ideas. It's most famously exhibited in Robert Nozick's book, Anarchy, State and Utopia, a right-wing riposte to the more social justice-orientated book of John Rawls, A Theory of Justice, and those two books together basically have set the scene for political philosophy ever since. A curious aspect of this kind of shift in perspective, which I think has to be understood historically, it may seem very remote from anything of immediate practical interest. We're interested in the economy, we're interested in the distribution of costs and benefits of cooperation, we're interested in perhaps our morality, you know, how to deal with our daughter who's going off the rails or something like that. Those are the practical affairs of life, and it's this interplay between our ideas, our concepts, the lenses through which we see the world, and practice, which has always struck me as the absolutely fascinating justification, really, for being interested in philosophy. People get very worried about the meaning in life when they think about the size of the universe or the length of time. The length of time there's going to be after you're dead. The length of time there's going to be after you're forgotten. The endless galaxies, hundreds of thousands, millions of galaxies in which you're not heard of. So we're very insignificant in the space of the universe, either in space or time. And then they think, oh, well, it would be better if we were bigger, if we lasted for longer, or if we occupied more space. And I think that's just a mistake. That's imagining a meaning arriving from mere lasting longer. But if lasting longer was just more of the same, it wouldn't give meaning at all. I mean, I find meaning in something like one of my children's smile, or meeting my wife after an absence. That's a meaningful experience. It wouldn't be more meaningful if it went on forever. So I think you have to learn to find meaning in perspective. In our perspective, people like you fill my perspective at present. I find meaning in trying to speak to you in ways that you appreciate or the ways that mean something to you. And if I fail in that, then this evening has no meaning for me. I want people to appreciate the power of ideas, the difficulty of ideas, the reason why taking command of ideas is so important and is better than having ideas take control of you. So there are going to be people who say, reflection, you know, I don't need that stuff. And it's certainly true. For large parts of life, we don't need that stuff. You want to know the bus timetable, you don't ask a philosopher. You ask the bus timetable. You go to Google, you search it and so on. What I'm interested in are the categories that structure our thoughts, the categories that structure our terms of cooperation, our politics and our ethics. If people say that that's not practical, I think that is itself a kind of blindness. We conceptualize the world, we think of the world in terms of concepts. Just take a concept like progress. You can immediately start to interrogate that and wonder what the costs and burdens of progress are. Think of a concept like reason. We all like to think that we're reasonable. You know, philosopher's supposed to be above all, a guardian of reason. Somebody like Hume comes along and asks us to interrogate the concept of reason. What makes for reason in human affairs? Experience. We all like to think that we learn from experience, but what's experience? Experience comes filtered. It's filtered especially by memory. How do we know when we're using experience in the right way and in the wrong way to come to ideas about things? You don't have to ask those questions, and some people have no interest in those questions. To me, a puzzle is there to be solved, so I do require a certain kind of ambition from a young philosopher.
Esta e outras reflexões sobre o mundo contemporâneo encontram-se também no site da CPFL Cultura. Tchau e até o próximo Café Filosófico.